compilation photographs. So I guess the recording just started, so I'll say a little bit of that again. This is Dena Selby, and she and Melissa went to Costa Rica right before the pandemic, and she's going to share all her photographs. So if you have questions during the talk, you can type them into the chat. Dena might answer them then, or she'll answer them afterwards. And afterwards, you can also unmute yourself and turn on your video if you like, and we can ask Dena lots of questions. So here's Dena.
Okay, thank you. And thank you everyone for joining us tonight, or if you're seeing the recording later, for joining us then. I am going to start, let me ask first, Cindy, are you seeing this?
Yes.
Okay, great. So my talk is about an hour. I'll be sharing experiences of a 10-day trip we took to Costa Rica, but don't leave after an hour because I have a 9-minute video of a kind of a slideshow I put together of some of the photographs put to music. So it'll be just a little over an hour talk total. And we went, Melissa and I went to Costa Rica in January of 2020. I was the one who chose what travel group we went with, and the group was Natural Habitat Adventures. There was another photography guide in Haines just the summer before who told me about Natural Habitat, and I really liked the idea. They were small groups. Most of them are about 9 people. We were 4 people with 1 guide and 1 assistant. Nice spacious vans. This one happened to be a photography tour, so we were able to stay in these camps and lodges and take our time with photography. Natural Habitat Adventures is also a carbon neutral company. They believe in conservation. A lot of money that you pay to go on the tour is given back to the community, and they are the only travel partner of World Wildlife Fund since 2003, which I think speaks well of them. The photographs I'm going to be showing were taken on 3 different cameras. My Fuji mirrorless camera had a 100 to 400 lens on it, but since it's a crop sensor, it really went to 600. I used that for the wildlife. You'll see a lot of pictures of birds mostly, and that would have been taken from this camera. The point and shoot was a Sony RX100. That pretty much I would pull out of my pocket and take pictures of the scenery. So that way I had a long lens and I had a shorter lens, and I'm pretty happy with the quality that the Sony RX100 gives. And then there was my iPhone as well, which didn't have the three lenses like it does now, but it did a good job. One thing I would say, if you ever go with multiple cameras, put your date and time, synchronize them. I didn't, and putting together the pictures was interesting because my iPhone showed up earlier than some of the other pictures in my whole Lightroom library. Our itinerary included going to flying into San Jose, the capital of Costa Rica. And you can see that in the top map, Costa Rica's in blue, just above Panama and below Nicaragua. Once we were in San Jose, we flew or drove or boated to three different ecosystems. First, we went to a tropical rainforest, which on the bottom map, you can see the Taquita Jungle Lodge. That was a tropical rainforest. It was right next to Panama. Then we flew to a mangrove estuary, which was the Serpe River, and Ballina, which is whales, is where we stayed, the hotel we stayed in. And then we went to a cloud forest, which is the Los Quetzales. because that's where we were searching for the Quetzal. The temperatures we had, and this is the end of January, on the left is the Tsiquita Lodge, and that was the tropical rainforest. The average temperature was 91, and yes, it was 91 and muggy and hot. We didn't get much rain. The real rain in Costa Rica comes more in the our fall months. Then jumping over to the cloud forest, which was the coldest temperatures that we experienced at Savangre, was around 70, 72 degrees, and very, very pleasant, I thought. The San Jose and the mangrove estuary were kind of in between those temperatures. So first hotel we were at was in San Jose. It was a Marriott hotel. We arrived a few days early because we wanted to be sure that we would be there when the tour started. You all know about ferry connections and plane connections when you go out of Alaska to other places. The nice thing about this Marriott was it was right in the middle of a coffee plantation, and the bushes you see to the right, those are all coffee plants. Since we had a couple of days to spare, we went to the spa and we walked around the grounds of the hotel. You can see very tropical appearing lush greenery. The bottom left shows one of the coffee plants that was nearby. And just to the right of that were some bananas growing. There were also birds we were starting to see, but I didn't take many pictures of birds here. You'll be seeing birds at the later locations. So since we had a couple days, I took a tour of the capital of San Jose. It was a bus tour. There were, you know, they pick you up at the hotel, they drive you to the city. Very cosmopolitan city. But what struck me there was all of the razor wire. You could tell that there was protection against crime there. And as soon as you got out of the city, in the lower right, you can see you were heading into poverty type housing. On the tour, they took us to the pre-Columbian Gold Museum. They took us to some monuments. They took us to Central Market. And I was fascinated by Central Market, these tiny little hallways just full of people and full of different kinds of wares. Each tienda had a different set of wares. Up in the top right, you can see the traditional coffee maker of Costa Rica, the Choriador. I'm sorry if I'm not pronouncing it right. It's basically a sock that you fit into this wooden structure, and you put in your coffee grounds, about a tablespoon per cup. You can put more if you want more coffee. You can also, after it's dripped through the filter into the cup, you can take the cup and pour it through the filter again to make it even stronger coffee. Costa Rica has great coffee. Once you've used this, you rinse it out and you use it again and again, and it gets better with time as the coffee oils kind of stain the filter. The lower left, you see the typical tortilla press. And the lower right, you see some of the fruits. Almost none of them did I recognize, maybe tomatillo. But they had many different sorts of fruits. And you see aloe vera hanging up there as well. Further on in the Central Market, there were herbs. In the top right, you can see they're labeled as to what you want to use them for. Cholesterol and triglycerides for the front one, and bronchitis for the back one, which looks like ginger. I've never seen cheese blocks this big. You can see that in the lower left. And then meat and live chickens. Just a fascinating, bustling place. The second day, we still had time off. So I did another tour to the waterfall gardens. You can see them by the map that it's a three-tiered waterfall, or excuse me, four-tiered waterfall. We were actually cut a little short in our time. So I chose to stay in the jungle cats, snakes, monkeys, hummingbirds area and frogs and take pictures. They had pretty much every monkey you would find in Costa Rica, 22 varieties of frogs, some poisonous. And then the hummingbird garden, you can sit there on a bench and they have like 10 to 12 hummingbird feeders, and you just sat there and you watched the hummingbirds. And here's some photographs from the La Paz Waterfall Park. To the left is the typical traditional ox cart that is a emblem of Costa Rica. You can see these in souvenir shops everywhere, little replicas of it to take home, very colorful. In the middle, there's a puma that was looking at me as much as I was looking at him or her. And then the hummingbird garden was amazing. Here you see a feeder, and it's got at least three or four different kinds of hummingbirds on it, as well as non-hummingbird birds in there. Driving along in the bus that took us to La Paz and back, a typical little store on the side of the road, people coming home from, I think, the laundromat, it looked like, with the clothes, and then coffee plantations everywhere. Lower left, you can see just many coffee plants. And on the right, you can see the long arm of Starbucks. The silo there has the Starbucks emblem for their Costa Rica coffee that they were making. Then we started our natural habitat tour. And the first thing we did is we got in a little plane and flew from San Jose to Punta Banco. And I believe the next slide, well, a slide coming up will show the map. When we were flying over, we got to the Pacific Ocean, and this here's the Pacific Ocean. One of the beaches is very well known. It's called the Whale's Tail, especially at low tide. You can see it looks just like a whale's tail. And in this area, whales do come to mate in the winter, in our winter months. We didn't do any whale watching, but they were probably out there. And we were supposed to fly to Sikita, the place that was just right above Panama, but it was fogged in. So instead, we landed in Golfito, a small town, and we took a taxi. They hired a taxi to drive us an hour and a half to Sikita. But before we did that, we stopped in Golfito. We had breakfast there. And then as we were driving along to get to the jungle lodge, we stopped at an estuary. One thing that really fascinated me while we were in the bush plane was, or small plane, no, that's called bush down there, was the different panels of the that the pilot sees. The very left, you can see we're over blue, we're over water. As soon as we start to land in Golfita, you can see we're getting into yellow and red zones, and you could see it too. We were going to a very tight spot. And then as we're landing, we're totally in the red. And all I could remember thinking is Paul saying, you just want to stay out of the red zone. Well, we were in it for much of our landing. When we were over the ocean, it was fine, but then we got into tighter quarters, shall I say, but we all felt safe. Even though there was also a break in the windshield with a hole in it, but we were fine. So driving from Golfito to the Sikita Jungle Lodge, we stopped at an estuary. And here you can see across the water, there was a typical farm. There's a cow and a goat. There was also a dog somewhere back there. But when you start looking around, the wildlife was incredible. There was an iguana high up in a tree. we got introduced to the national bird of Costa Rica, the clay-colored thrush in the lower right, left, I'm sorry. And in the middle, at the bottom is, I think, one of my favorite birds, the bare-throated tiger heron. And bare-throated, because you can see the yellow of the throat, that means that's it's bare of the barred markings that makes it the tiger heron that are on the wings. And there was an egret in the water. Continuing driving along, we saw cows, lots of cows and oxen. And then we got to Punta Banco, which is where our first main stay was. What you're seeing here is where we ate at all the meals. It was an outdoor sort of area. And that was also the main office area. So now we're in the tropical rainforest. This area was a great place to go to because it used to be an orchard that then has been grown over, which means that the wildlife have come back in and populated it. So there were a lot of birds and wildlife to look at. These were our accommodations. You can probably tell which bed is which. Mine is the one with the tripod and the long lens, and Melissa's is in the back. Once you walked through the main room to the back, the bathroom was open to the wilderness. So you had the sink and the toilet, and then further on you had an open air shower. And I know Melissa saw a Coda Mundi eating a jackfruit just 30 meters from the wall there at one point. So we were right there in the wilderness. Different vegetation in that area. We went on a walk around the orchard. In the center is the cocoa bean. You crack it open and there's the beans, the seed pods in it. And we sucked on some of them. It kind of tasted like chocolate cocoa, but I think they really need to ferment it before they process it. And to the right is the jackfruit, which was everywhere around there. And the Coda Mundi loved the jackfruit. You can see at the bottom of the tree, Alex, our tour guide, holding his tripod and spotting scope. And so you can get a feel for how big the jackfruit was. It's what, like five times the size of his head. They were huge. So here we get our introduction to some of the animals and reptiles that are seen in a tropical rainforest. The agouti, which is pictured here, is a relative of the guinea pig, only it's bigger. It's more like 5, maybe even 10 pounds, and it's got longer legs, but it is a rodent. And we saw them. In fact, one was running around with her little baby. I'll show you a Coda Mundi in a moment. We got introduced to the squirrel monkey. The howler monkeys we only heard there. And it sounded like they were coming from the beach, and it sounded like a herd of elephants were crashing through trees when they were howling. The howler monkeys at Sakita Lodge on the dot 5:45 in the morning. I heard them the first morning, and then I set my alarm clock for just before 5:45 for the next morning. And right at 5:45, they started howling again. Then we saw our first sloths here, many birds, frogs, some of them here poisonous, and the reptiles, including scorpions. So we were told to wear closed-toed shoes at all times, even though it was 92 degrees and muggy. And this is Coda Mundi. It's a relative of the raccoon. It's also known as the hog-nosed raccoon because of that long snout. We watched one of them eating a jackfruit for like half an hour. He just posed and was beautiful photography material. You can see they had that prehensile tail. They used that for signaling other people or for grabbing onto branches. They also can turn their feet like 180 degrees or more. So they're able to walk head first down a tree, which not many mammals can do. When we went on a walk in the orchard, we saw a couple of spider monkeys. This one was a little bit in the foliage, so I had to use a high ISO, but he performed for us. He did his little, he did his acrobatics through the trees, and they tended to be single when we saw them. We didn't see them in groups. And we saw our sloths. Basically, you look up in a tree for a gray ball. They don't move much. Reading up on them a little bit, they spend 95% of their time in a tree. They eat, they have babies, they do almost everything in the tree. And their metabolism is very slow. They eat the leaves, that's pretty much all they eat. And the acids and the microbes in their gut break down the leaves. So they're spending all their time just chewing and eating. They don't do any grooming. And you can see that without grooming and with them walking so slow and not moving around much, they actually get algae growing on their fur. If you look, you can see the fur is green. That's algae. But there are two-toed sloths and three-toed sloths. I didn't ask which these were, but I'm counting three toes. I also read with the metabolism so slow, they could eat a leaf in August and it doesn't get eliminated until October. So then we did bird watching around the area of the lodge. Saw a number of hummingbirds. We also saw dragonflies and other insects as well, and other birds as well, vultures. I can't name them all. I'll show you pictures. We spent one afternoon going down to Punta Uvita, which is a small town with a beach, some beautiful birds. Saw our first macaw, scarlet macaw here, saw a toucan and a parrot. And the beach itself is just a beautiful scenic Pacific beach, Pacific Ocean beach. The main reason we went down there though was to talk about the turtles there, these sea turtles. There's a conservation effort going on to let the eggs hatch and to watch over the babies and make sure they get to the ocean okay. And in the lower left, you can see that was taken in the area where the hatchery is. They've got it marked off in grids, so it's easier to count the turtles. And they'll watch them and decide when it's time to release them. And we were able to watch a release. The first release, we watched the 152 little turtles went into the ocean. Three of them didn't walk to the ocean, so the guy picked them back up and took them back to the hatchery. And then we went back again in the evening and saw another 30 get released. This is a conservation effort. It's sponsored by a nonprofit organization that is trying to make sure that significant conservation efforts are made and people are paid to make sure turtles do get back into the ocean. Before that was what happened, the villagers were known to pillage the nests and eat the eggs. And once they started a kind of people being rewarded for guarding the nests, the turtles have been doing okay. And it was time to leave. This is the landing strip that we would have landed on if we didn't go to Golfito. It's just grass and there's horses. You can see in the right-hand side, that are right next to the landing strip. We did have to wait an hour or so for the clouds to lift. Otherwise, it would have been a 7-hour drive to our next stop. So instead, we got in the plane, and then Jose, the guy in the blue, he drove the 7 hours and took the van to meet us there, which was really nice of the tour group, that we could spend more time photographing and looking rather than on the road. So the next place we went to was a mangrove estuary, and we flew over the river we were going to be on, the Serpe River. This is what it looked like. It's a tropical river, and it is full of creatures. First we landed at the airport, and then we went on a boat. The first boat wouldn't go backwards, so we had to go back to the dock and switch to another boat, and we got another guide as well. But so here we've done airplane and van and boat, as well as walking. So the next 3 hours were just pure bliss, going around slowly, seeing what we could see. There were a lot of crocodiles. It was very hot. So you can see the crocodile has his mouth open to let off the heat. Oh, I forgot to mention it. Sakita Lodge, after we did that Orchard Rock walk in 92 degree weather, your clothes were just sticking to you. And I just went in the shower with my clothes on, because it would have been too much trouble to take them off. And you cool down, and then you can take your clothes off. So I bet the crocodile felt that way too. We saw numerous crocodiles, some of them just with their eyes above the water, but others basking in the sun. Saw our first white-faced capuchin. These are the monkeys that you typically see with the organ grinders. They are omnivores. They were generally found in groups, and they wherever we saw them, they were playing. The first group that we saw seemed like juvenile delinquents. They had scars on their faces, and they seemed a little bit mean to each other. The second group we saw, it was more like kids at recess. But these are a couple of them that we saw. All kinds of birds. I can't even begin to name how many or what birds we saw. Colorful water birds, birds in the canopy, birds in the trees, ibises, muddy ibises, the little blue heron. And the interesting thing here is the little blue heron, when it's immature, which is the one on the right, looks is completely white. So it's a little hard to tell the immature blue heron from an egret. But I'll point out here, the little blue heron immature has this pea green legs, whereas the egret on the very left has those yellow feet. Their beaks are a little different. The way they walk is a little different, but the biggest and easiest way to determine to me was the legs. On the left is a Jesus Christ lizard. It's got a long tail, which allows it to actually skim across the top of the water. We didn't see that happening, but we did see a few of these Jesus Christ lizards. And then we saw iguanas in the tree. Scarlet macaws, there was one tree that was just full of them. We also saw a little bit of just day-to-day living. These are workers returning home. They take a barge across the river to get to their houses. It was like around 2 in the afternoon when we saw this happening. And then near the river, The tour guide, Alex, knew of a place where there were two scarlet macaws that had taken up residence in a hollow log. So we were able to go there and watch them. These are two different pictures. One of them is where they're both in the log looking at us. And then one of them is where one, he climbed to the top and then flew over to a tree. But that was fun to watch. Then we stopped at a park that had these stone spheres, bolas de piedra, which is balls of stone. They were created in just before the Spanish invaded the territory, because once the Spanish came, no more balls were made. And actually, they weren't even really found or just till the 1940s. And of course, by then, nobody knew what they were used for. They could be just a centimeter or so in size, up to 4 meters in size. This one was about 1.5 meters wide. You don't get a good feel for the size, but if you look at the tree trunk, which was a mature tree, you can kind of get a feeling for the size of it. They're man-made, made of an igneous rock, very hard rock. And really, it's not known what they were used for, but some of them had been found in along lines approaching chiefs' houses. So maybe they were just demarcating important people, but really nobody knows what they were used for. They're very smooth. Most likely they were hot coals were put on it, cold water were put on it to kind of fracture it down to a sphere. And then it just slowly they polished it with different methods to get it to that fine luster. But the stone spheres of Costa Rica. So once we did our tour of the mangrove area, we went to our next hotel, which was also still fairly close to the Pacific Ocean. It's, if you look on the map, the Serpe River was the river we were on, and then the Baena Hotel is, Crystal Baena is where we went. Had a nice pool, we didn't take advantage of it. What we did take advantage of was all that greenery. We sat there and we watched for birds. This was also very close to that whale tail region of beach. Here we concentrate on birds, but we also drove down to the beach and saw howler monkeys. And these howler monkeys woke up 15 minutes later than the ones at Sakita. They woke up at 6 a.m. and you could hear them sounding like elephants crashing through the trees at 6 a.m. So this was looking out our room, the view we had, and walking around the hotel. They had some pre-Columbian reconstructions. A stone sphere. It's I don't know if those were real ones or recreated. And the colorful, Costa Rica has a lot of art that has very colorful painting on it. The big demarcation here was the Three Sisters, which is a three-pointed island just off the coast of where we were staying. And did I mention birds? There was one tree looking right out the backside of our hotel room that in one morning had 12 toucans in it. Other birds, as we looked around, all different colors. Some that I recognize, the red-winged blackbird in the upper middle. And all I could do was sit back and enjoy them. One interesting one had set up shop in the parking lot of the hotel, the Montezuma Oro Pendula. You can see a male next to the nest. The nest is this elongated web of different brush They can be up to 6 feet long, but these were more like 1 to 2 feet long. And let's see if I had anything interesting to say about them. Yeah, they basically are usually in the forest canopy, but this guy happened to set up shop in the hotel parking lot. We did another afternoon walk on a hot, muggy day. We didn't see much because I think it was so hot, the animals were all resting. Alex, our guide, did smell a tapir, which is like a kind of like a wild boar. So he called us all over. We didn't see it, but we could smell it. It smelled like a wild pig. And then we came to this gate that had a lock on it. Alex unlocked it, and we walked to this one tree, which is a pretty famous tree. It's a ficus that has these buttress roots, and actually all tropical rainforests, I think you could find trees that have these buttress roots, but this one was just more of a magnificent example of it. So the roots, because the tropical, the rainforest areas, really it's only the topsoil that has good nutrients. So these roots kind of make their maze at the top of the surface of the soil. There's not like a deep tap root. There's more these buttress roots, and they're also called buttress because they're holding up the tree. And in another picture, you'll see us standing between these spaces that the roots provided. It was huge. They're like 5 to 6 feet tall. In the parking lot of this park that we were at, where we saw the tree, we also saw a sloth. First, we only saw it as a big brown gray ball, but when we came back from our walk, it had moved a little bit, and we were able to get some nostril pictures of it. Then we drove and drove and drove to what felt like the middle of nowhere, and stopped for lunch at a place that had water on both sides. You can see that it was significant with seafood. I had gotten shrimp, and I just remember the different smoothies that they offered, and they were very good. And it shows the ingredients, and the ingredients are very basic, just pure ingredients that we could probably make here or on our own, and which I think we have tried. While we were driving there, we did meet a capuchin. He was just sitting on the side of the road, and he was showing us how to eat grubs. And he's there on the lower left. The best sloth, though, was right outside our hotel room. And I love this guy or gal. We watched it through a spotting scope. It didn't move for many, many minutes, and then wanted to scratch its hand. And I wrote in my journal that we watched it scratch its hand, and it was painfully slow. They really move very, very slow. We went down to the beach, and this is where we saw the mantled howler monkeys. The ones we were hearing at 6 a.m. here. It was raining, you can see. We saw a mom with her baby on the back, and then we saw another mom teaching a baby to swing through the trees. We watched them for quite a while till we got rained out. There was also a sloth in the area. They didn't howl when we were there. They just were busy eating and moving around in the trees. And here's the mom with kind of showing a baby how to move along the trees. Then we started our way. We left that area and we were heading towards the cloud forest. First, we stopped at a little beach where we were told a lot of expats lived. It was a surfer town and there were probably a fair number of Americans there. We dipped our toes into the Pacific Ocean. And I noticed that, yeah, we could go into the ocean, but if you looked a little bit to the side where the water was feeding into the ocean, there was this big sign saying, crocodiles, don't go in, don't do anything. So we stayed on the ocean side. And we started our drive to the cloud forest. Here we're going up in elevation. We are seeing clouds. We're seeing stores with tropical fruits. Here's more, many types of bananas. I think there's more than one variety there, mangoes and pineapples. And we stopped at a place where we could, where they had a area set up with fruit and feeders. And we watched the birds there while we sipped hot chocolate and ate monkey brain fruit, which was very good if you got past the name of it. It was nice and sweet. This, again, is the national bird of Costa Rica, the clay-colored thrush. And some other birds we saw feeding on the fruit that had been put out for them, as well as a bird busy making a nest at the top of the building. We had lunch at a farm. This is the farmer and his wife in a typical farmhouse, nice big kitchen. Alex is standing next to the chorreador where they made coffee, and you can see the farmer and his wife making the coffee in the next picture over. We ate family style, and just looking around the house, you could see there was a lot of emphasis in terms of pictures with family and then with religion. And then there was the ever-present dog. There were dogs everywhere in Costa Rica. After lunch, which I can't even tell you what it was, but it was all delicious. I can tell that there's a banana in there. But after lunch, we went and saw the farmer to supplement his income was growing mushrooms. And this is a program that was set up by the government. They helped subsidize getting the logs and the inoculum. And then he grows the shiitake mushrooms and re-inoculates them and sells them to stores and restaurants. So we continued up the cloud forest. We went on the Pan-American Highway, and I didn't realize it. I thought the Pan-American Highway is, it's in Central America, but it starts all the way up in Prudhoe Bay and goes all the way down into the lower part of South America. We were on the part in Central America. And because of the way the geography was created, as I understand the Talamanca Mountains, which we're going to be driving in, came up as a volcanic island, and then other tectonic plates kind of pushed other land around them. But because of that, it's created its own ecosystem. And there's certain birds that are only found in along the Pan-American Highway in Costa Rica or in other areas. So now we're heading into the Talamanca Mountains. As I was mentioning, that there's these a certain number of endemic birds that are only found there. I could name off six of them, but we saw one of them. We were also going to search for the quetzal, which is a bird that's only found in Mexico, and Central and South America. And the first place we stopped at as we were driving along was the highest mountain peak, Cerro de la Muerte, which is the mountain of death. And it's at 11,500 feet. And why it's named that is because people who would walk across, you know, they'd start at sea level and they'd think, you know, nice temperatures, we can walk across this area. But it suddenly got cold and maybe they weren't wearing shoes. There were landslides. There were areas where there were hundreds of feet drop off. So a number of people died in that area. But as you got to these higher elevations, the vegetation turned into more brush, rocks, stunted trees. And we were able to see one of the endemic birds in that area, the volcano junco. I'd never seen that before. Alex kind of just, you know, punched me on the shoulder and said, "That's a rare bird. Take a picture of it." So this is the La Concepcion area of Cerro de la Muerta. You can see the vegetation. And then right here is the volcano junco. And you can see a highly studied bird. The one in the bottom right has two bands, one on each foot. And in the upper right, different juncos in North America, Central America. And at the very bottom, you see the VOJU, which is the volcano junco. And that is the total area that it is seen in. It's seen at about 8,000 to 11,000 feet, right in that area. And up until this day, we were pretty much just a group of four with our guide and our assistant and the assistant. And now we're getting in the cloud forest and we're getting into bird territory. And there were bird watchers everywhere. I mean, I have pictures that looks like nobody's here, but I kind of had to edge in between three other people to get a picture of my volcano junco. And that's how it was for the 2 days we were in the cloud forest. This is heading down to the third place that we stayed at. We went down a bit. We were probably at around 6,000 feet, crossed over a little brook, and then got to this gorgeous flowering area where the hotel was set up. And this was the third and final place. If you look on the map, it's the Los Quetzales area. We stayed at the Salmon Gray Hotel. I have it here. The altitude was 7,200. And this area is well known for birding, hummingbirding, and the Quetzal. And it was chock full of people. Everybody wants to see, wants to make their life list of birds. And the hotel itself had an area where it had a lot of feeders set up. So we could go to that area and sit and watch and take pictures of all kinds of different birds, woodpeckers, cardinals, again, the clay-colored thrush. This is only a sampling of what we saw. And then all the different hummingbirds as well. It's nice when the sunlight shone on them. One thing I will point out, the fence that they used to surround the garden in the bottom right, they were just logs that they put up, kind of, you know, instead of using, I don't know, railroad ties or something that's unnatural, they took very natural ingredients to make their fence, and slowly it's grown lichen over it as well. So it's more hummingbirds. The volcano junco, the volcano hummingbird, they like the word volcano here, on the left-hand side, it was about the size of my thumb. It was a real tiny little thing. And I liked it. It buzzed around really nicely. And you can see the different beaks on the hummingbirds. It really is a birder's paradise. This was the room we stayed in. And one afternoon that we were there, we took a truck just like this one. This one's loaded with people's luggage, but we went in one and we went up a mountain. And we went to a place where, again, this couple had set up a bird watching area. They gave you food, and they had put out fruit to attract different birds. We saw a Baltimore Oriole there. And again, we saw a lot of hummingbirds. One trick that Alex showed us, one of the feeders that the hummingbirds were going to constantly, he then took up some flowers. This is in the lower right. He took a big flowering pod and dunked it in sugar water. And then when the hummingbird went away, he moved the feeder away and he held the flower there. So that way we could get a picture that looked more natural. And I kind of liked that trick because it does. It looks like you're kind of in nature rather than at the feeders. Then we went to search for the resplendent quetzal. And this is the basic area. There's multiple varieties of quetzal. The resplendent one is pretty much here. You can see in Central America where it's found, the green areas. The best place to look for the quetzal is by the agua, the agua cotillo tree, agua cotillo tree, which is it's related to the avocado, but the fruit only gets to be like nickel sized, but you get thousands of them on the tree. We didn't see the fruit. The fruit actually comes later in the year, but the quetzals still hang out around these trees. So that's where we were headed, was to this tree. But before we could get to that tree, just as we drove out the hotel area and started heading up the mountain to get out of the valley region, we saw a whole bunch of cars on the side of the road. And you know, it's just like in Haines, you see a whole bunch of cars, there's probably a bear. Well, a whole bunch of cars, there's probably a quetzal. And we saw our first quetzal. And this is a male. He's got that blue aquamarine feathers with the feather on out. He's got the red breast. If the sun's shining on it, it's very iridescent looking, and the colors change. They can even change to kind of a lime color or so. Back in Aztec times, when the Spanish came, they saw that the currency that was being used was either cocoa seeds or quetzal feathers, mostly. So they were very, very valued and still are valued. They're not quite on the endangered list, but they're close to it. There's like about 50,000 quetzals left, resplendent quetzals left in the world, and they're considered near threat. And I want to read just a quick thing about the quetzal. A guy named Thor Jansen was sent out in 1978 to create a pamphlet about the quetzal in Guatemala. And he found some agua cotillo trees. He sat there for 10 days before he saw a quetzal. And actually we were told that a lot of people coming from all over the world to see this bird may have to come back 3 times before they finally see one. But this person wrote, Thor Jansen is his name. He wrote that the male quetzal is a supreme beauty, the most beautiful of all things considered that I've ever seen. They owe their beauty to the intensity and surprising contrast of coloration, to the elegance of their ornamentation, to the iridescent luster of their feathers, to the near perfect symmetry of their form, and to the nobility and dignity of their presence. So we were very lucky. We saw 2 quetzals, one at one stop, one at another stop. But when we got to the cotillo tree, we didn't see the quetzal, but that was fine. We were able to see these guys. Then we went to lunch. Like I say, it's a birder's paradise. We went to lunch at a place that is set up for birders. You sit and you have your lunch, and then you have a 15-minute window where you get to go out on the porch and look at hummingbirds. And you can see just the number of birders that were there in the lower left. There was one hummingbird that was only seen in this area, but I didn't see that one. I saw these guys. Now, some of the food that we had first with the coffee. Costa Rica is known for its coffee, and yes, it was very smooth, very good. This 1820 coffee that we had at the Cicada Jungle Lodge, I asked the lady, could I buy a bag? And she said, absolutely. It was $2.50 for that bag. Then remember I mentioned we had breakfast in Golfito? Well, I had pinto, and pinto means a specific thing in Costa Rica. It's what's in the upper right-hand corner. It is a leftover rice and beans from the night before that are then mixed with spices and bell peppers and onions. And if you say pinto, that's what you're gonna get. And I thought it was funny. Alex and I both ordered pinto, and we looked at our plates at the end of the meal, and we'd both taken our bell pepper pieces and put them off to the side, but still tastes it. It's very good. The seasoning was good. And we were introduced to the Lizano salsa seasoning. It's kind of like Worcestershire sauce, but a little more mellow. And found out you can get it on the internet. So my refrigerator has that in it all the time now. Some of the food we had, of course, tropical fruits. I really ate a lot of papaya and mango. Seafood was popular at all the restaurants, being mostly on the sea area, and pretty much always the ever-present tortillas with your meal and salads. And don't even get me started on the flowers. There were so many beautiful flowers. The best place that we saw the colorful flowers were the cloud forest area, but really we saw them everywhere. So here's a picture of us at the tree. That's the four people that were on the tour, and then Jose, our assistant, in the back. But you can see how tall the buttress roots were. It was just really a fun trip. It was hot, but it was in terms of wildlife and birding, it was just incredible, awe-inspiring. So don't leave. Let me see about getting this this slideshow up that I had put together. Okay, can somebody unmute and tell me if you see a blank screen?
Yeah, it's a black screen right now.
Dena. Okay, thank you. I'm gonna start it, but before I start the slideshow, let me tell you three things. One, the first few slides don't have any sound, so don't try to put your volume up. Another is I put the wrong name for the heron. It's the bare-throated tiger heron, ignore fasciated. And I also have my egret and my juvenile little blue heron mixed up. But other than that, I hope you enjoy this. It's a little under 9 minutes. Oh,
que voy a hacer si tú me martirizas? Pegarte un tiro, darme al alcohol, o soportar que me hagas trizas la sol, para después salir de mí como un suspiro. ¿Qué voy a hacer? Amar contra corriente, dejar de amarte, huir de ti, o estar bailando en tu balanza eternamente. Tú me tienes así, en la punta de tu lanza, un granito de esperanza, al borde del amor y la sol. Tú me tienes así,
tú me tienes.
Okay, I might need help getting back on the regular screen with everybody.
Hold on.
I'll stop screen share maybe.
Yeah, I think that'll do it.
There you are.
Okay, there. And I see there's one chat. Oh, thank you, Kathleen. So, yeah, any questions? The scorpion was shot under a black light.
I was wondering about that, yeah.
Yeah, I was just at another talk by someone doing Milky Way photography. And he said the first time he went to the Milky to meet with people and do Milky Way photography, someone said, okay, who wants to go scorpion hunting now? And he's like, oh, they're just trying to, you know, pull a leg on the new kid. He's like, what? But they were serious. They pulled out their black light and went scorpion hunting.
Yeah, I had some friends that I used to go camping with in the desert. We'd been camping for years without tents, just sleeping on the ground. And they went to the same place and pulled out a black light, and there were scorpions all over the place.
Oh my gosh. Oh, willies.
So I have a question, but first I'd like to say that was just magnificent, Dena. I mean, the photographs are amazing, and I loved all the information that you had. And so I really didn't end up having very many questions. But I have one, which is, why is the clay-colored thrush the national bird? It's like the only bird that's not dramatic,
not colorful. In some way. I didn't search that out. I don't know, but yeah, I agree. That struck me too.
Yeah. Anyway, you put a lot of effort into that, and it was very, very nicely done. Thank you for sharing with us. I really appreciate it. So maybe someone else has questions.
And feel free to unmute yourselves to ask questions if you'd like.
Yeah, thank you, Dena. That was just, it was a wonderful trip that we had, and I enjoyed that so much, and I just enjoyed getting to see it all again and bring back so many memories.
Thank you, Melissa. Dennis has his hand raised.
Yeah, does the clay-colored thrush have as melodious of a song as the hermit thrush?
I can't answer that. I don't think I heard it.
Well, yeah. That answers it, I guess. You'd notice if it was a beautiful song, eh?
Okay.
There's a comment in the chat there regarding.
That is my brother. Hi, Julian. About the crocodile, if he's hot or waiting to eat something. Now, he didn't move. He was just sitting there. Actually, we saw a number of crocodiles with their mouths open and just cooling off.
Now, Julian. Since you had an iPhone, why did you bring a point and shoot also?
I had an iPhone 10. I'm not, now that I have an iPhone 13, I don't know if I would even bring the point and shoot. Good point. Because it really is getting that good. But no, the Sony RX100 has I'm very happy with the resolution of the photos. I don't think I'll ever give it up. Okay. Well, thank you everyone for joining, and for whoever watches this later on.
Yeah, thank you, Dena. You're in Arkansas right now, and so it's about 8:15 here. What is it there?
Yeah, 11:15.
Okay.
So. Well, thank you.
Okay. Staying up late for us.
Yeah, thanks for staying up late. And for those of you, I know we all know friends who are birders, you might tell them about this talk, and they can find it on the library website, because I'm sure that birders especially would really, really love to see this. So thank you, Dena.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's going to be a bird walk from 8 to 9 on Saturday before the Earth Day deal. The Bald Eagle Foundation is doing that meet at the school parking lot. So somebody that saw this and is going to that might mention it to them. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, Dena.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Cindy and Russ.
Yep. All right.
The library.
Yep. Okay. Bye, everybody.
Okay. Bye.